Hi guys, welcome back, and today we're going to talk about a very unpopular set piece, which is the throw-in. Why do I want to talk about this? Number one, you get around 30 throw-ins per game from one team, so that's around 60 for both teams. It is the most commonly occurring set piece, but yet people don't talk about it and coaches don't train. And in an interview, I think in 2018, Jurgen Klopp was like, yo, I knew it was a problem, but I didn't know what to do. The next year, when they won the Champions League, they hired a throw-in coach. And it is the same throw-in coach from FC Midtjylland, I think. And they won the Champions League that year using throw-ins, because their percentage of ball retention after throw-in went from something 56 to 68 or 70. And that itself is quite the jump. And you wonder as to, you don't have ball in your court, you have ball in your hands. If you have ball in your hands, it's like, and everyone is static, it's the most predictable situation that can be on the pitch. And if you win throw-ins in the right areas, it could be very useful to have it as a really nice weapon, a very strong weapon. Okay, so without further ado, let's go to the board and think of one or two variations of throw-ins which can technically work.
Okay, so we are here, we are the red team, the yellow team is defending, and we have a throw-in, let's say a little bit further, halfway down the second, on the opposition half, somewhere here. Rule number one, what you want is, number one, is you want a wide player on the opposite side, because the goal actually is to hit him. Because you look at this, like, teams compress over here, and the goal of this to hit him and make him hit the byline somehow. How do you do that? You have three phases. Number one is the throwing phase, number two is the layback phase, and number three is the switch phase.
So in the first phase, what you do is you want a setup where your players are actually behind the opposition, so they're here, and if the opposition would concede space, they'll just go behind. You try and do that as much as you can until at some point they'll be like, okay, this makes no sense. So you want to be behind the opposition if that is possible, and you make two runs. So number one is further back, which will force it, and then you go forward. So now you have created some separation between you and the defender. That's number one. That's the first phase of throwing. Another one is setup. So basically, if this guy is blocking this guy is supposed to be the guy who can switch the ball. So you want to give him space. You move these players away from him. And any one of these players could be the layback players. So you go, make a run, pop. This guy throws the ball in. Make sure that the throw-in is on the feet and it could be played one or two touch. So, bam, on the chest, knee height, not a good idea, on the feet, which can be played. So once you created, have this setup where they are behind, you create some separation from all angles, whichever one you prefer, and then lay it back. So bam, throw in, lay back, quick pass back, and this guy, now you have created time and space for this guy to be able to hit this ball. The whole idea is within two or three passes, you want to be able to switch. Now, how you do it, I just gave you one example, and you can come up with more creative solutions, such as just basically, if you have really good technicians on your team, then you can just do a quick layback and cross it directly in. That's also impossible. If the ball is right here, you have a good person who can throw it in. No problem with that. Rory Delap, I think in 2008 or something, he played for Stoke City, and he used to just throw the ball in like a corner, and people used to head and score a lot of goals that way. That is also an option. Key aspect is, do not lose the ball. You cannot lose the ball on your own throw-in, because it's just criminal. You have the ball in your hand and you throw it in high accuracy. You can play it back, and at minimum, you should retain ball possession from a throw-in. At the best, there is a delivery into the box, some or the other way. But you have to really think about that. If you want new ideas, you can look at basketball plays. Like, if you see basketball throw-in plays, they are complicated plays where they have some play and then one guy gets free for throw-in. And you see, if you see any Michael Jordan or Steph Curry highlights, you'll see that they have these plays so these two guys can get a shot in. And that's pretty much what you're trying to do. You're trying to create a movement where the ball is played back, and this is your long range shooter, boom, and then you have time and space, as I talked in the previous video, to attack. Take this, even just the tip of just spending time on throw-ins will benefit you a lot.
So now we have talked about attacking throw-ins. Next video, we'll talk about how to defend throw-ins properly. That's it for today. See you next time.